Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Captain Patriotic. How are all you doing today? I know it's been a long time since we've last seen and spoken to each other, but I hope everyone's doing okay with all the madness that's going on in the world right now. Now, as you'll recall the last time we talked, it's been a few months ago now, and sorry it's been such a long time posting new content, but I've just had a lot going on in my life right now. In fact, I actually just moved into my first place about a month ago, which thankfully I'm finally settled in and everything is taken care of right now. I'm so thankful to be in my own space, for sure. Now, as you'll recall, the last time I posted an official video, I started a series on Native Arkansans who have gone on to receive the nation's highest military honor, which is the Medal of Honor, for gallantry action in battle while serving for one's country. And if you'll recall last time we talked about this, the very first Arkansan that I talked about that received this honor is none other than the great General Douglas MacArthur. Now, for those of you who might have missed that episode, General Douglas MacArthur came from a military family. In fact, his father actually served during the Civil War, the Indian Wars, and even the Spanish-American War in 1898. But what is so cool about that, though, is that General Douglas MacArthur's father is also a Medal of Honor recipient for one of the battles that he served in during the Civil War. So, General Douglas MacArthur had a lot to look up to. In fact, he enlisted and served in the Army just like his old man did, but this time he started doing his service around the turn of the century. Now, this man would go on to serve in not only the Mexican Revolution of the 19-teens, but also World War I, where he served in many different battles, including the Battle of St. Mihiel and other land battles of World War I. But he also served in the Pacific during World War II, where he was officially the commander of all U.S. Army forces in that Pacific theater of war. His Medal of Honor citation was for the systematic retreating of U.S. and other forces off of the Philippines in 1942, whenever the Japanese officially invaded the Philippines, trying to take over all the islands in the Pacific during World War II. So he is often regarded as being a master planner. I mean, he was responsible for initiating the island hopping campaigns that were used extensively in the Pacific during World War II by the Marines, Army, Navy, everybody that served in the Pacific. But another accomplishment to his credit, though, his last official war that he was a part of was the Korean War. Now, in that particular war, it was in the early 1950s, just 5 years after World War II ended. But basically, General MacArthur served as the supreme commander of the UN and US forces that would eventually repel the North Koreans back over the border into North Korea. Anyway, enough about MacArthur. Today, I wanted to shift our focus back to World War II, where we talk about another, maybe not so well known, but another significant Arkansan who served his country greatly during the Second World War, Marine Private Wilson Douglas Watson. Now, Private Watson was a sharecropper who grew up in Earl, Arkansas. Besides serving as a farmer, Private Watson enlisted in the U.S. Marine Corps and served in many different land battles in the Pacific during World War II. Now, he earned the Medal of Honor for gallantry action while fighting during the Battle of Iwo Jima. Now, Private Wilson Douglas Watson was born on February 16, 1922, in Tuscumbia, Alabama, to Charles and Ava Watson. Now, he was the oldest of 8 kids that this family had all together. So I guess you could say he had a lot of people looking up to him for sure. I mean, He was the one, main one that would help his dad in the field and get all of his brothers and sisters to come help the family out whenever they need to. I mean, he grew up a typical farmer family lifestyle. In fact, he only had 5 years of schooling before he decided to quit and work on the family farm full time, as was pretty typical in those days, you know, especially during the early 1900s and the Great Depression. But hey, it was a great way of making money, and his family actually fared well during the Depression. Well, by 1940, his family had actually moved to a farm up in Earl, which was in Crittenden County, and they were actually sharecropping for a guy named Tom Sellers. Very, very popular guy up in that part of the state. I mean, his family had a lot of responsibility and a good job working for this guy and everything else. Well, as you would imagine, 1940, you know, World War II is really just starting out in Europe, and the U.S. is wondering, oh, are we ever going to get involved in this conflict again like we did the last World War? I mean, there was a lot of questions being raised. So, yes, eventually we would be involved in this war because of the Japanese bombings in December of 1941, which, if you haven't seen my interview video of Navy World War II veteran Bill Chase, you should totally see that. He is a great guy to know. But anyway, so fast forward a couple of years to 1942. Now, you could imagine what the atmosphere of the United States was like at this particular point in history. The Japs had just bombed Pearl Harbor, thus thrusting the United States in another world war. But unlike the First World War, this one, the U.S. actually fought on two fronts. The first one being in Europe as well as Africa, but the second, and probably the most interesting one, was in the Pacific Ocean theater of World War II. Now, it was during 1942, June of 1942, that Wilson Watson goes ahead and signs up for the draft. Officially, he signed up for it on June 30th, 1942. But shortly after he signs up for it, he gets to thinking, you know, why do I want to wait to be called to military service? Like, more than likely, I'm going to be called to fight anyway. Why not just get it over with? And, you know, he had other family members that had served in the Marine Corps in different conflicts. So he thought, hey, the Marines will treat me right. Maybe I'll just go and enlist in them. You know, that's exactly what he did. In August of 1942, he actually enlisted in the Marine Corps. In the Marine Corps Reserve, rather. But since our country was in the middle of the war this time, there really wasn't any reserves of any kind because they needed every man they could fight. But anyway, after he enlists in the Marines in August of 1942, he is shipped out to basic training in San Diego, California, where he gets trained in many different specialties over the next few months, specifically in machine guns and other infantry-type duties that a typical Marine regiment would experience in the Pacific during World War II. Before he shipped out to the Pacific in January 1943, Wilson Watson was considered to be a private in Company G, 2nd Battalion, 9th Marines, 3rd Marine Division. Now, being in a typical Marine unit like he was, his unit was subjected to many, many island land battles like all the other Marines and the Army and other infantrymen fought in the Pacific during World War II. In fact, the first battle in which he participated in was actually the Battle of Bougainville, which took place between November 1943 and March of 1944. Now, after Bougainville, he served in a couple of other smaller island campaigns or whatever, but probably the next famous battle that he participated in was actually in the Second Battle of Guam. Now, that particular battle took place between July and August of 1944, Well, in both battles, Watson served as an automatic rifleman, as the service called him at that time, and his standard issued weapon of choice was a Browning automatic rifle. Here's a picture of it so you guys get a better idea of what it looks like. Now, this particular weapon was really popular in World War II, but it actually officially entered service with the U.S. military during World War I in 1918. It was designed by famous gun developer John Moses Browning. And what made this gun so popular is that not only could you fire it from the shoulder, but it was also very accurate and good if you're firing from the hip. They called it walking fire during those days. Now, it coined that term whenever a soldier during World War I, you know, they had trenches all around the world and everything. Well, a soldier armed with this rifle could get up into no man's land and literally fire from a his hip into an enemy trench. Now, this was revolutionary because during the early 1900s, during World War I, most all machine guns were mounted on some tripod and couldn't be moved easily. This particular weapon pioneered that for the better, and it was very well known for clearing out German trenches all over the Western Front during the later part of the war. In fact, it became so popular that it became standard issue to the military during that time, as well as continued to be standard issued during World War II. I mean, this was the standard issued automatic weapon for all the branches of the military, including the Marines, Army, Navy. I mean, everybody used this weapon. In fact, this weapon was still considered popular then, and it continued to be the standard issued automatic weapon of the U.S. forces well into the Korean War of the 1950s, and it even saw service in the early days of the Vietnam War. I mean, it was in our military service for well over 50 years before it was finally retired. Anyway, it was Watson's job during both of these battles to basically go in front of the men in his unit, and they basically used this Browning automatic rifle to clear out enemy entrenchments of Japanese soldiers, and it basically cleared the way for his platoon to go in and finish off the whoever survived, or the stragglers, so to say. So, and he was very good with that gun. I mean, everybody praised him for his accuracy and everything. Anyway, that continued to be his main role throughout all the island campaigns during his time in World War II. So, fast forward a few months from the Second Battle of Guam, which ended in August of 1944. He continued in just little skirmishes and all that, but the next famous and probably the most significant battle in which he is highlighted for his service for is the Battle of Iwo Jima. Now, the Battle of Iwo Jima was important to the United States because if you look on a map of the Pacific Islands and everything, you'll see that Iwo Jima is really, really close to the main island of Japan. I think it's right about 1,000 miles or so from the main island of Japan, which was perfect for the U.S. because that meant that the main island was within plane and bomber squadron distance of us to go in and bomb and invade the Japanese main island. So Iwo Jima was very crucial in that we could use it to recapture an island and use it to base our planes off of and possibly use to reach the main island of Japan. It was during the morning of February 26, 1945, when Private Watson's squad was pinned down before a Japanese pillbox fortification. Basically, it was like an underground bunker, basically. And there was a lot of these throughout the island. But basically, his men gets hunkered down by this pillbox. You know, Watson decides, you know, we really got to take out this bunker. Otherwise, we're not going to make it whatsoever. So what does he do? He decides to charge that fortification alone. I mean, alone. There's nobody else to back him up. And while he's charging up toward that pillbox, he keeps on spraying it with his BAR and basically trying to kill every soldier that is in that thing to get his men up that hill. So while he's continuing to move up toward that pillbox, he keeps firing his gun and changing magazines and doing all this stuff. It's actually pretty cool what he does. Now, he does this until he's within throwing distance of a grenade, which he throws right in the middle of the pillbox where the machine guns are and all that, and ultimately blows up and kills all the enemy soldiers within that particular compound. No, but he doesn't stop there, though. After the grenade goes off and kills most everyone in that pillbox, there's still a few survivors. You know, they're coming out of this pillbox, and just as they're retreating, he unloads his BAR on those remaining surviving Japanese soldiers, which ultimately clears the way for the rest of his platoon to advance toward their next objective. Now, that's pretty cool in itself. I mean, who else would be brave enough to brave machine gun fire coming from all directions around you and just go up and basically be a bad A about it and take out everybody inside? I don't know about you, but I know I couldn't do that. Well, anyway, the story continues. On the next day, February 27th, 1945, his platoon is once again pinned down by enemy machine gun fire. Now, for the second time in a row, the young private again advances toward this rugged hill where this pillbox was again. And under intense mortar and machine gun fire, he reaches the crest of this hill while firing his BAR the whole time. Now, once he gets on top of this big hill, I mean, there's nothing for him to stand cover by. I mean, he's totally exposed, and he's up here at the top of this hill right here, and the enemy's down here trying to shoot at him. They're shooting this way up here. I mean, he has nowhere to go, but the only choice he has is to fire down on the enemy down below him, which is exactly what he does. Now, he continues to empty bullets and all that into an enemy pillbox just down in the valley below him. Now, he continues continuous fire down on this enemy fortification for a good 15 minutes or so, while in the process, this whole time, he kills a whopping 60 Japanese soldiers. That's right, well over 50 Japanese soldiers. And the only reason he stops firing down there is because he totally runs out of ammunition and doesn't have anything else he can throw at the enemy. But even then, this man single-handedly takes out a whole whopping part of a battalion of Japanese soldiers. I mean, that's pretty bad, eh, if you ask me. I mean, man, that's crazy. But anyway, he well did his job that time. And I mean, taking over 60 men by yourself, that is crazy. So, and basically, once he does all that, his platoon rejoins him, and then they go on to their next objective. Wilson Watson continues fighting in Iwo Jima for about another week or so in March of 1945, while they're still fighting at Iwo. He gets injured in an intense firefight. I mean, a lot of his comrades thought he was going to die or whatever, because he ends up being shot 7 times, with one of those times being in the neck, as well as being injured from Japanese mortar fire and grenade fragments coming into his shoulder. Anyway, it got so bad that he had to be medically evacuated from the battle, which ultimately ended his involvement in the war altogether. But and don't worry, this is a good story. Thankfully, he survives. Now, his gallantry and heroic actions don't go unrecognized whatsoever. In fact, it is his commanding officer in that unit that ultimately recommends him for the Medal of Honor. Now, this is his citation from his commanding officer that would ultimately cause him to earn it later on down the road. And I quote, "For conspicuous gallantry and intrepidity at the risk of his life above and beyond the call of duty as automatic rifleman serving with the 2nd Battalion, 9th Marines, 3rd Marine Division during action against enemy Japanese forces on Iwo Jima, Volcano Islands, 26th and 27th, February 1945, with his squad abruptly halted by intense fire from enemy fortifications and the high rocky ridges and Craggs commanding the line of advance, Private Watson boldly rushed one pillbox and fired into the embrasure with his weapon, keeping the enemy pinned down single-handedly until he was in a position to hurl a grenade, and then running to the rear of the emplacement to destroy the retreating Japanese soldiers in order to enable his platoon to take its objective. Again pinned down at the foot of a small hill, he dauntlessly scaled the jagged incline under fierce mortar and machine gun barrages with his assistant automatic riflemen. He charged the crest of the hill while continuing to fire from his hip. Now, fighting ferociously against Japanese troops, attacking with grenades and knee mortars from the reverse slope, he stood fearlessly erect in his exposed position to cover the hostile entrenchments and held the hill under savage fire for 15 minutes, thus killing 60 Japanese before his ammunition was exhausted and his platoon was able to join him. His courageous initiative and valiant fighting spirit against devastating odds were directly responsible for the continued advance of his platoon, and his aspiring leadership throughout this bitterly fought action reflects the highest credit upon Private Wilson and the United States Naval Service. So even his company commander was convinced that he was such a great Marine and a valiant leader, for even being just a private, that really stood out for the company commander. And thus, he sounded like he really deserved that honor for doing all the things that he did. I know I certainly couldn't have done a fraction of what he did. That's like crazy. So thus, Wilson Watson was officially awarded the Medal of Honor by President Harry Truman on October 5th, 1945. Now, after World War II ends, you know, he decides to go back to Earl to be with his family and all that, and he's basically given a hero's warm welcome home. In fact, whenever he comes home on October 25th, 1945, the mayor of Earl, he orders all businesses to close from 1:30 to 3:30. I mean, it was a big celebration. I mean, they even had a parade in his honor and everything else that you could imagine. He was a small-town hero for sure, and he was warmly accepted for it by his friends and his family. You know, he was a hero in his own sense. Now, after World War II ends, he finally settles down and has three kids. You know, I think it was a daughter and two sons and whatever. You know, he lives the quiet life for a while, and he's still in the Marines, too. However, fast forward 5 years later, he's called back to active duty again. For this time, he served a tour of duty during the Korean War from 1950 to 1951. And thus, he made it back home from that war as well. So he is a two-war veteran. That's pretty impressive all in itself, for sure. So after he got out of the military, he again settles down with his wife and his kids and all that. And, you know, he continues to live in that part of Arkansas for many years. Eventually, he moves to Russellville, where he dies peacefully in his sleep on December 18th, 1994. Now, he's officially buried in Russellville. So, he didn't quite live long enough to retell his story as much as I'm sure he would want to. But if you ask me, that is a really, really impressive story all in itself. I mean, one, to enlist in probably one of the hardest and the noblest branches of the military to fight in the greatest conflict in U.S. and world history, that's pretty impressive all in itself. But to face the enemy head on like he did, I don't know hardly anybody that could have done that nowadays. I mean, that's really, really impressive. So anyway, this is the story on Wilson Watson and how he earned his Medal of Honor by serving in the Marines at the Battle of Iwo Jima. If you love these stories and want to hear more of them or have any ideas, please feel free to leave a like or a comment below. I really appreciate any insights you guys have. Well, I'm going to take a break for the next couple of weeks due to the holidays, but after the first of the year, we are going to continue our series on Arkansas Medal of Honor recipients. I have a couple more World War II stories I want to share with you guys. As always, thank you for tuning in, and please stay safe out there, and happy holidays to you all. Thank you.